our gaming lab that's part of the i3DL lab is geared to do that under the concept of collaboratory. The collaboratory is our industry engagement arm for the College of Technology and Innovation, and it allows for opportunities to bring companies and connect with them to technologies that are not, you're not doing basic research, but you're taking that research and applying it for a commercial solution.
The gaming certificate fits very nicely with the mission of the college, which is to pursue interdisciplinary, systems-oriented, and industry-engaged education. And the gaming certificate does exactly that. It very much so moves students through and focuses on a particular industry, allows them to apply their talent from a computer science, software engineering perspective, and apply that to build real things, real games, real programs, real outcomes from that, which is very much what the college is about. Hands-on, applied, project-based, engaged learning.
So in the College of Technology and Innovation, we are pushing forward with concepts that relate to gaming, modeling and simulation, virtual simulation, and so the constructs that are useful in gaming, same ones for fun and entertainment, are just as useful for education and training and what we call as serious games.
Games underpin many industries today. We don't think of them as games, but it's a simulated virtual environment. That sits underneath healthcare. All of our military training is essentially simulation and modeling based in a gaming environment, if you will. And increasingly, education is moving toward the use of virtual environments for collaboration. So all of this, put simply, are happening in a gaming environment.
Welcome to the Gaming Lab at the College of Technology and Innovation at Arizona State University Polytechnic Campus. My name is Ashish Amresh. I'm an assistant professor here, and I run and manage the curriculum development activities as well as the research activities for the gaming portfolio at on this campus. What we're going to show you today are an array of different projects that showcase our expertise and what we've been capable of so far and where we want to go down in the future. Well, we're going to start with our first project, which is a heat map based combat simulation training project that we got funded by the Science Foundation of Arizona.
Hi, my name is Ryan Anderson. I'm a senior research engineer here at ASU. Previously, I'm a game engine programmer from the video game industry. Spent about 8 years doing various handheld and console video games. Currently, I'm working on the Science Foundation of Arizona funded heat map project, where we use heat maps to visualize combat training. And we'll be showing you a little bit of this project as we move along.
Perfect. So this demo is to show how heat maps can be used to facilitate training. Heat map is a visual representation of data over time. In this case, we have a top-down projection of our game level, or our world here, and it shows a heat map of position that shows where the players have been. This is about 15 runs of a player through the world, and as a player traverses a location more commonly, that location on the heat map will go from a dark blue to a light blue, green, and even to red locations for places that are very commonly visited. In this case, it's an expert player who's played this, and as an expert player finishes a level, the heat map will be saved and will be accumulated with every successful run. So this is one way to show how behavior can be tracked by a heat map. The simple rule of this game is that you ought to take cover. While perhaps a trivial rule, it shows one way that heat maps can be used. If we look over here to our left, you can see that there's a corner and we cannot tell what's back there. Given the tank in front of us, it's fairly obvious that we probably ought to go over here to the right-hand side. We see a bad guy back there and we can shoot him. Now, if we'd gone around the front side of the tank, we would have been open to to direct fire. We have the same decision over here. If we look to our right, we have a corner around a house, not knowing what's over there. I could, quite probably intelligently, walk to the left side of this vehicle. But we will just intentionally walk on the right side and immediately start being shot by a bad guy who was hiding from us. Now, if we look at our heat map here, this is our accumulated expert heat map, and we can show our current heat map. Now, our current heat map colors aren't going to be as important because we haven't gone over this area more than one time, so they're all going to be in the brighter color ranges. It's pretty even and averaged out colors. but it does show our position with respect to the excerpt's position. As you can see this initial little bright yellow red spot right here, you can see that most of the expert players came to this spot and took cover for the bad guy who ended up being down to the south here. Once again, they came across, and you can see it gets bright yellow, maybe even a little bit pink right there, as the expert player took cover again. Now, in our heat map, while we did come down to this approximate location and took cover the first time, we then deviated from the expert heat map by taking the wrong path and went in front of this other vehicle and was open to the enemy fire who was up in this northern area. So in this way, we can see that the novice player has made certain deviations from an acceptable expert behavior. Position is not the only thing that we can capture in heat maps. We can capture the direction people are looking. We can capture the direction people are moving, which is not always the same as the direction they're looking. We can capture where people are shooting at, where people are shooting from. When is someone ducking or crouching or jumping? What is in view? What objects are in view? And we can see what expert players are looking at. One great use for this would be so we can verify what the experts would consider to be correct training with their actual behavior and see if what they are doing equates to what they are saying they are doing. One final area that would be interesting is that a trainer could real-time watch a player as they were creating their path or their heat map and compare it with an expert heat map and show where they deviated and be able to discuss what some of the decisions they're making on. Again, this is a fairly simplistic position-only heat map, but this can be extended to all kinds of information.
And then we're going to follow that up with a project that we've been working on for the last year and a half, where we test domain expertise by creating a spelling game.
My name is Tyler Kilborn. I'm a graphic information technology student here at ASU, and my focus is primarily on web development, so that's where I kind of interact with the gaming part of it. I'm interested in Flash development, so I develop Flash games. I'm working with Ashish and Resh on my capstone project and my senior portfolio at ASU. So the game that we've been developing is called Word Fighter. It's currently in the alpha stage. It's a spelling game with a fighting element to it. So as you can see, each player has a board of tiles where they must select individual letters to form a word. Spelling a correct word will perform an attack on your opponent. Periodically, additional letters drop for each player, and whenever you create a word, it will launch additional letters at your enemy. So you win by filling up your opponent's board with letters.
So the main objective of Word Fighter is to reinforce domain expertise by the concept of spelling. And then the way we achieve this is, right now you're seeing the entire dictionary in front of you and you're fighting with words that are available in the entire dictionary. Now, you can restrict the dictionary in the same game and have it be just animals instead of the entire dictionary, and they can play the exact same game and test how well they can spell animals, and so on and so forth. The boundaries are limitless, and the game really doesn't have to change much. It's just the dictionary that keeps changing and restricting or adding new sets of words. What we can now also have the ability is not only have it on a PC playing online, but we can even have this running on the mobile phone, your handheld. Right now, we are showing you how we're playing versus a PC versus a mobile phone. So we have complete cross-platform capability in our portfolio to engage in games and reach across multiple audiences at different levels, whether they're just standard casual PC players playing via Facebook, or if they're hardcore gamers playing on the Xbox 360, or if they're just casual players who just predominantly play on their mobile phones. The next last one that we want to show you is a math game that we've been working on, which focuses on understanding math without losing any of the fun game elements that make games really fun. So it tries to approach games and learning math from a game designer's perspective rather than a math teacher perspective.
So I'm Ryan Scott. I'm working on the game Mathbound with Ashish Amresh. I'm currently a senior computer science student. All right, so Mathbound is a game where we're kind of testing some simple concepts right now. This is just the first level. So you've got basic shape recognition down here. If you look at the top left-hand corner of the screen, you can see I can cycle through shapes. And whichever shape you're currently on will be shot out of you. If you shoot a shape at a similarly shaped enemy, they will be destroyed, like so. And if you shoot one that is not the same, you will lose all of your boost. So you just got a boost reset there, and it was not destroyed. As you can see, I'm collecting these fractions on the ground here, and they're filling my meter over on the right, which is whenever I complete a whole circle, it will fill the boost bar slightly. And what the boost bar does is lets me move faster. Makes me jump higher. All kinds of good things that help me do the level better. It also protects me from death against an enemy, though only once. When you get hit by an enemy, all of your boost bar is depleted. If you shoot a shape at the wrong enemy, your boost bar is depleted. If you incorrectly complete a fraction, your boost bar is depleted.
So the main objective of Mathbound is to have a continuous gameplay without having to really hand solve equations or open up like a text window and start writing math. Because what kids absolutely hate is if they are somehow told to do exactly what they have to do in class in terms of homework using a game, which is what most games currently are trying to do. Here, what we're trying to do instead is to see if they understand the concepts that they learn in math. Do they understand fractions really well? Do they understand shape recognition really well, depending on their age group? So shape recognition works really good for kindergarten. Fractions will work better for elementary kids. But the underlying theme is the same, that we'll have a continuous fun gameplay without any interruptions, and all the learning happens on the side. So if you understand your domain really well, you're going to be an amazing player of this game. If you're not, then you're going to still play the game, but it's just going to be a horrible experience for you. And that is going to propel you to go and understand the concepts better because you really want to succeed in this great game and get a really high score and have the bragging rights and so on and so forth. So that's the design methodology of Mathbound, and we feel like this new way of attempting to reinforce math learning is going to be a significant jump from the games that we see out there today.